Make sure the second person is when they start to talk. Tomorrow, all day, when you see different people, you can ask them your favorite teaching tip because you'll see new people. Can I get anybody who wants to share something that was shared at their table? It doesn't have to be your own tip, it can be something somebody else told them.
Yeah.
Yes.
I had a great tip from a student last semester. So I take computer programming under the student's program. Sounded like crickets. I go through code traces. They haven't engaged. And I would ask, and then I have a question, and no one would budge. So
I got to talk to the people and all that. Teachers introductory programming, 150 people. Everybody's quiet. You ask for questions. It's crickets. And?
A student suggested, instead of asking, does anyone have a question, I should say, does anyone want me to repeat this?
Okay.
And hands went up, and they gave it. They started the semester, so I thought that was really useful. And that's my idea.
Sure. Students shared an idea. Those are great. Those are the best suggestions. Yeah. Instead of saying, raise your hand if you have a question, say, raise your hand if you want me to repeat that, right? So that's a much less intimidating thing, and as a student, you don't even have to open your mouth. Anything else? Yes.
Beth, I'm Frank, from UC Riverside. The number one tip I give to any teacher is to follow your work. Simon and Porter, 2013-60, peer instruction. Don't just go up there and lecture, but break it up into activities that the students can do that just completely transform how we educate
them. All right, Beth is going to do a bad job repeating that one.
Exactly. So Frank, our my colleague from UC Riverside, who you'll be hearing from later, was basically making a push and a plug for using peer instruction instead of lecturing.
No, from you.
Okay, yeah, self-referencing. One more, right here.
Okay, so this is my favorite thing in the world because I helped do it. Use a little tiny bit of Gender Mag in any course, just a little tiny bit. Gender Mag is a method for making technology more inclusive.
Okay,
you just need some bit.
Okay, we're going to use something called Gender Mag.
Yes.
Go for it.
In your course, and it will make people feel more included. It will make them act more inclusive. It will make their grades go up. It will make their retention go up. And it will make the student evaluations of you go up. At least this is what our data says.
Okay, so we're all going to look up Gender Mag.
Because
it has...
She wants an example. She wants us to give an example.
Okay, give an example.
Okay, so part of Gender Mag is some personas about different ways people go about stuff. So in an introductory web design class, instead of saying, make a web page to, you know, show your name, say, make a web page to show your name and make sure that this persona is going to be able to use it fine and that persona is going to be able to use it fine. And that much makes them think about other people and not themselves.
So adding on to your activities or your assignments, particular use cases or user personas that really get them thinking about that. And there were lots and lots of really good outcomes that were listed. And we'll, again, clearly somebody else should make turn with them to set it over there. So we're going to go along. Again, what I'm going to do is until 4 o'clock, I'm going to share with you three of my favorite things that some of which are just favorite, and I actually have very little evidence of efficacy, but I believe others have it, and some of which I've spent a long, long time documenting. And after that, at 4 o'clock, we've got six people who are each gonna share 5 minutes each on a favorite thing, just to tweak your interest and give you more options for things you might think about doing in the next two sessions. So I'm going to start by talking about, as Frank mentioned, peer instruction, because that is what everybody knows me for. Peer instruction may also be called using clickers. I'm going to talk a little bit about the difference. There's a tool and then there's a pedagogy. But let me explain the motivation for peer instruction and why I first started using it in my computer science classes about 5-6 years after I started teaching. Our traditional lecture approach is like, okay, come to lecture. You can tell kids to read the book before lecture, but seriously, is that going to happen? As one of my students, why would I do that? I might fall asleep and then I would be embarrassed. That was in a very small class of my institute. But anyway, then maybe the kids are like, oh, there was something I didn't understand. Maybe they'll go open that textbook to maybe read up the hard stuff. We give them an assignment to see if they can check for themselves if they know the hard stuff. And then bang, on the exam, we have mastery knowledge. Thing is, this is really, really discarding your value as an expert teacher, right? So the approach that we take in the flipped classroom, and this active learning classroom, is leverage the textbook. By the way, this doesn't work quite so well if you don't have a good textbook. But a lot of us do in many of our classes. Actually assign students to read and give them the motivation by giving them a quiz right before class. Then you come into lecture and you gotta change your slides. If you're gonna not cover the basic stuff, you're not gonna introduce the three parts of a for loop. I will commonly use CS1 as an example, but anything. You're gonna go to the hard stuff. You're gonna think, what is it the kids usually get wrong? You're gonna try to write a question that will elicit that knowledge. Then kids could go do their assignments and do their exams. So now we're taking much better advantage of your expertise of knowing what it is students have struggled with learning and how you can get them to encounter it directly in front of you in the classroom, not down in the basement lab sometime that you're not there, right? And so hopefully they can ask you questions, et cetera. So the way that peer instruction appears to the students in the classroom is you come up with a question. The question is important. Asking students how many beers they had last night is not going to help them learn, in this case, big O notation. And every student in the room will vote. And there's a variety of technologies you can use for voting. What is shown here is a clicker, an old style manual clicker that does not access the internet. After that individual vote, I will not share the results. It's just to get everybody to commit. Then they get to discuss. So because everybody committed, they've all got something to say. They can only say, well, I thought it was B, but I don't really know why. Right? And they have groups. Then after they finish discussing and how long, just listen for the level to go down. Then you ask everyone to vote again. And that's really important. Also, making kids accountable, you gotta at least listen to the people in your group. And so you know where to vote the second time. And then we can have show the results of that and have a discussion where I can elucidate any confusions. I actually particularly like to call on people and say, somebody tell me why somebody might think it's A. Oh, okay, you decided B was the answer. What was your explanation? So you get them to explain every answer option. All right, we're gonna try this ourselves because it's like talking about it doesn't really do much. You gotta try it, but we're doing a hack because you don't have clickers and I didn't want to haul much with me. So we're gonna be using Google Forms in the place of the clicker. So let me get you started. There is, oh yeah. We're gonna look at this question and you're gonna think about it individually. And then you're gonna vote using this QR code or that link at the top, you go to the same place. Our question is, what does this code do? I'll give you time to look at it. It's perfectly fine if you don't know the programming language. I ask this to psych majors on the first day, so I promise you, you can make a reasonable guess.
That's more to me.
I'm sorry?
More as 3 dots means continue on the next slide.
Whatever you think it means.
Are we supposed to vote?
Everybody should go ahead and vote. Give me a little time. If you don't want to mess with technology, you can just mentally in your heart hold up your hand. 1, 2, or 3. Does anyone still need the cure? All right, now here's the most important part. There are somewhere between three and eight people at your table. I'd like you to talk in pairs. If pairs doesn't work, one of you come up in a group of three. I'd like you to discuss this question and say, be able to talk with each other about each answer option, because each of them is meaningful. And could that be right? Is that right? Why might it be right? Et cetera. So you guys have about 3 minutes to discuss. Go. All right, second time. All right, the level of the conversation actually just went down. So that's what you must support. Everyone should go a second time based on how you feel after your conversation. And this is a different to your And while everybody else on Zoom is voting, here's what was happening in the room at the table as well. You couldn't see. They're all doing this and talking, and they were talking in groups of large groups, whatever. All right. I'm going to do, and by the way, normally when we have clickers, because these things can just click the button anytime, and thousands of votes can be recorded. I say, fun. 4, 3, 2, and let's see if we can see our responses. Hopefully, I'm logged in. This is why this is not the favorite way of doing peer instructions. Oh,
look at that.
We only got 10 responses, but they all said, hello, that is interesting. Very cool. All right, let's get back to the next. Get to back to my screen. There we go. All right. So, what we'd like to do is I'd like to ask somebody in the room, tell me something that you guys talked about at your table or in your group. What's something you talked about? Yeah.
We talked about what it meant to, I can't remember what it said, do together. Is that whatever the second block said?
Yep. So, they talked about what does it mean to do together? Okay. Did anybody not even see the do together card? You're all computer scientists. All right. Anybody else? Tell me something you talked about at your table. Yes.
What does it mean to move up and down at exactly the same time?
What does it mean to move it up and down at exactly the same time? Is it exactly the same time, et cetera, et cetera? All right. Anybody want to share something else? Yeah.
How would you change it to do each of them?
They talked about how you could change this code to come up with each of these possible outcomes. Preview that is the best thing to get students to do, because I just say, well, I'm not going to ask you that question on the exam, but I've already got these answer options. I'll just whip in a different piece of code and you'll already be prepared if you just come here. Mm-hmm. Which students did say about peer instruction. I didn't even have to study for the exam. I learned it along the way. Okay, that is a great quote. All right, who wants to give me an explanation of one of these options? A, B, or C? Doesn't have to be what you voted. Yeah. Sure.
So originally when I was first looking at it, I was kind of thinking A, but I noticed do together. And so for number A, that could happen if those three lines happen one after the other, as opposed to kind of all at the same time.
All right, so she was saying at first, and oh my gosh, this is like the quintessential quote. At first I thought it was A, because in this case, she didn't see the do together. And so that's how it executes sequentially. Anyone want to give me an answer for another option? Yeah.
So we were talking about C.
Uh-huh.
Makes Bing would say hello.
Okay, it's there's
going
no
to,
C.
It's going to make Bing would say hello.
Right.
One way or another.
Okay.
It doesn't matter what else is going on. The Bing one is going to say hello.
Ah, so they're going with the, at least I got a first choice right option. Which is, the computer is going to say hello. And, you know, that's just going to happen, et cetera. Anybody want to, familiar with Alice or otherwise has seen this before, wants to give an explanation that you might have come up with? Otherwise, I'll just, yeah.
So for B, I think it's like concurrent programming, in which instruction takes turn being executed, like timeshare.
Uh-huh.
So they don't need to do it parallel, like move up and move down, but just take turns and do, you know, a little bit of that and then a little bit of something else.
All right, this is why this is the best question for computer science professors. So she talked about concurrent programming and this, that, and the other. And yeah, I used to do supercomputing parallel programming. And any compiler people can come up with an answer or the explanation for any of these options. And it's great because they go crazy places. It turns out it is in fact true that Alice does just have these two actions get canceled out, and the penguin says hello and absolutely nothing else. In the class, I would then go demo that so we can see how it happens. All right. So this is the idea, right? We try something, maybe we don't know it, maybe we just miss something, but through discussion with each other in the zone of proximal development, people can have that aha moment and learn something more. And by the way, fun to do in the middle of the term, you say, oh, beforehand, only 60% of us got it right. And now 96% of us got it right. You're like, you just saw learning happen in this class. How many of your other classes can you say that about? And you get a little like, very, but it's cool. It, so it shows growth mindset. Yes.
So would you not typically share the before and after results every time, or is that sort of discouraging?
I don't share before and after results every time. I almost always show the after results because otherwise they're just going to ask to see them.
Right.
I like to do it like a good like second week to sort of show that, and then otherwise I might do it once more, but it's not really necessary. And students know if they got it right or wrong. It can be the advice to show when a lot of people get it wrong.
Yeah.
That is reinforcing in a good way for the students who are like, I heard them, right? So, but it does take time. All right, now I have to think about my time and what I want to do. I'm going to skip this part. Isn't that always fun? All right. So if you want to know more broadly about peer instruction, this is the plethora of references pages. But to highlight what we know about peer instruction, particularly in CS, we know that students want more instructors to use it. Across the study of quite a few instructors, we know that failure rates are lower in classes that use peer instruction. Students perform better. That's been measured in a variety of ways. I personally have measured it with exam scores. There's evidence that it scales better than lecture for large class sizes for student evaluations. That's the, hey, Mikey, I liked it kind of evaluation. And that was a study done at UCSD. The bigger the class gets, the worse your lecture. If you're lecturing, the worse your evals get, unless you switch to peer instruction. And then if you care about this, when you combine with other practices in MOOC, it does improve outcomes, particularly with female students. So you guys will have all of these slides, but there you go. Now, here's the caveat. There's a shocking amount of stuff that kind of goes into this. We're talking about, do you show the first one? Do you do that? Do you do whatever? clickers, having people vote, it's a tool. You can use it poorly. You can take any tool and do bad things with it. So there are a lot of information that if you're interested in adopting this, that you'll be able to explore tomorrow. And you want to be able to use the practices that we've already tested out and made sure that worked so that you get good results. All right. Next, perusal. How many people have heard of perusal? Okay, just a few people. There's going to be some very happy people in this classroom. Okay. So perusal came out about 2016, I think. It actually is related to peer instruction. So peer instruction was originally developed for university physics classes because they're like, kids could be like, you know, there's a big truck, hit a small car, you know, what is the force on it? People would say, do you want me to solve the problem in physics or tell you how it works in the real world? And they're like, oh my God, right? So they started doing this, but the key to peer instruction, if you remember my slide a few worlds ago, students start by reading the textbook, all right? They learn the basic stuff from the textbook, not everything, learn the basic stuff, and then they learn. They realize nobody understands physics textbooks. Okay, you got 200 students in the class, maybe you got two or something. So perusal is an online, interactive, free for you textbook reading tool, or you can just find papers for your research group if you like that. This is an outdated way of what it actually looks like, but it's a good user interface in person, not so great for projecting. But here's, say, a physics textbook that a student would have rented using perusal for their e-textbook rental. They highlight something and then they make a comment, and people can respond to their comment. Like, why is this? I don't get it. And then somebody will explain it, right? So this is the basics of how it works. So what you do as the instructor is you assign digital reading on a deadline. Like, you need to do this reading by 11:59 p.m. on Tuesday. And you can say, I want you to interact or comment on with that reading at least two times. And it automatically grades for you. You don't have to grade. Machine learning is good, guys. This is like, again, back in 2016. So they award points for quality. Your students will complain, but I thought that was a good comment. You're like, hey, it's machine learning algorithm. I can't do anything about it. But no, I'll give you advice on how to do that. And additionally, it will produce a confusion report for you, the professor, which I have to admit, because I haven't actually taught into a programming with this since I've done it. I haven't used, but you can then go most upvoted question, things that maybe you need to address and watch. Okay, so students actually get incentivized to read. If you're a peer instruction user, you can get rid of your quiz questions and get a little time back. And that all works great. And again, for me, you can use it for technical textbooks, like in that physics sort of model, like what's going to happen. I've started teaching classes for people who want to prepare to be K-12 computer science teachers. And I'm assigning like readings, like here's a Huffington Post article on the Facebook newsfeed algorithm. And yeah, I could do that and then have required a discussion question online because all my classes are online. But if I just do this, people read with intent and they comment within the context of the actual thing. And I was working with some undergraduates developing this, and they're like, I know what your goal was, but you told us to respond four times. That's killing me. They're like, I have to think carefully. What do I want to say? How do I not look like an idiot in front of the other students? You know, how do I write something that will meaningful, you know, apply to other students that they'll appreciate? And I'll just say that in my use of this with UC San Diego undergraduate students, they say they really appreciate learning from other people at the university. They're like, I knew our professors were smart, but you know what? UCSD has some smart students too. Okay, this is a great thing. So there are other things you can do with it other than technical books. Research paper reading, if any of you have signed research papers in a graduate seminar or an undergraduate seminar, you can do that and use it for free. Again, I talk about sort of like my impacts of readings. You can actually also ask some of the difficult things, like instead of having a discussion section where you might put this thing out, people are like uncomfortable talking about like how social media affects high schoolers, or is my life really being ruined by social media? Might be a better prompt, right? You could put that on a reading so students would have time to think and then compose their answer. And if you want to, you can set it so that their answers are anonymous at least to each other. We have internet yet?
No. Oh, not the real thing, but
okay.
We have five people on with us.
All right. We're going to see how this goes. You guys can tell me what to do. The last thing I want to do is share with you something I've just learned about in the last couple of years. And I've been involved with the Computer Science Teachers Association. They got a U.S. Department of Education grant to support English learners in doing better in AP computer science principles in high school. And I've gotten this opportunity to work with English language development experts who love the fact that I know what semantics versus syntax is, because nobody else does, and totally understand that, you know, we have a vocabulary issue in computer science. We have lots of new terms for students. We use some words in a completely different way than people do in English. Things that make things cognitively challenging for any student, regardless whether they're learning English or not, right? I'll tell the joke, okay. So I went and worked for this Nobel Prize laureate, a physicist Nobel Prize laureate. He's been working at a university trying to help improve STEM teaching. He goes to the first day of a computer science class and he comes back and he's like, Beth, what is wrong with you people? He's like, here's the list of words that the professor used that nobody would know because they're, you know, technical words that students who don't have prior programming can't do. And I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, I might do that. I don't think about all the jargon that I have, that is just part of my language now. And it's hard to do that. I mean, really hard to do that. But by working with these experts, again, focused on English learners, I've really understood how learning a programming language is like being an English learner. And all of this really increases the cognitive load on your brain. So we can do things to help students dealing with cognitive load. So here's the story of CS Real. Today, I'm gonna share with you two type strategies that we're going to do. And our goal for the CS Real project, by the way, in the high schools is don't inhibit the learning of computer science because of lack of English proficiency. Yes, those kids do need to become proficient in English, we know that. But we're not going to make computer science off limits to them because of that. Today, I'm going to share two strategies that we're used with them, pair share structures and sentence frames. And I'll say, even after our first summer professional development, I'm like, OMG, my discussion sections are going to be good. It's going to be so much better. And it is so much better. It's better for my TAs and it's better for the students themselves. So let me give an example of both sentence frames. Yeah, of sentence frames. So the question we just did, I might include, and I probably do it always in the same place in like a color-coded way, a cute little sign that's like a frame from a car. It says CS Rocks, but it's a license plate frame. And then I'm gonna provide some, these are actually called sentence starters here. I told you what to say, but especially if your like brain is kind of overloaded and like catching up from what we've been doing in class, then you get to this point and I'm not talking anymore and you're like, what am I supposed to do? All right, well, here are some sentence starters that if you're feeling uncomfortable talking with people, you could say, I think it's A because. Someone might think it's B because. I'm confused about this question, which by the way, when I say, what's something you said at your table? That's really nice because then people are like, we discuss that we don't even understand this question. It's confusing. So always be open. But sentence starters or sentence frames can provide anyone with a little bit of a light lift for their brain as you're busy trying to learn computer science about what is it I'm supposed to do. Even better is pair share structures. I'm gonna put up QR codes. If your first name is between A and L, can you try to scan that top one? And if you're M through Z, probably scanning it will be fine. This should open Google Slides.
What are the online teacher issues?
Jacob links on the previous slide.
We have a breakout.
Yes, it would be good. She should have that.
Okay.
You're probably saying I'm going to pass.
Yes, that was the reason I asked.
Good. Were people able to open the Google Slides? Yeah, okay. Well, cool, we're gonna give this a shot then. Let me go back to the instructions and then I'll show you what we're gonna do. So here's our instructions. You're going to have 8, maybe 10 minutes because, you know, technology. Each person is opening their own set of, well, a Google slide, which is shared with the other half of the people in the room that share your names. Okay. And you're going to find tables are shown in the Google slide. Table one, I didn't number the tables yet. All right. Tables, here we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. All right. So scroll down in those Google slides till you find your table number, and then grab and put your name on one slide that somebody else has not already put their name on. There's lots of copies of the slides under each of those.
You can't type
on. All right, that was my favorite. All right, we're gonna play pretend. So at least you can all see the slides. And here's what I want you to do. I want to, each of you to mentally answer, you wrote your name down, you wrote your partner's name down. Now, everybody individually, you're gonna think about this question and you're mentally writing a response that you would normally type in, all right? After you get done with that, and I'll give you guys 3 minutes and then I'll call time, then you're gonna turn to a partner. This one really needs partner talk, so move around if you need to. And you're gonna share your answer with their partner and they're gonna share their answer with you and they're really gonna listen. Because what you would then magically do is paraphrase your partner's response so that you are actually listening. And then the two of you will discuss what you'd like to share with the whole room. So individually think of your answer. You can write it down if you want or not. Find a partner, share with each other, imagine paraphrasing what they said, and then talk about what you want to share with the whole group. Ready, set, go. Now, about 3 minutes for individual thinking. If you have enough slides sharing with the partner and making sure you know which one to share, go ahead and do that.
I'm going to make that favorite.
See, now I'm going to do this whole thing where I got to like call on people. Whereas the people that are actually put responses in here, I could have been flipping through, finding responses while you're all of a sudden working out. Then I can at least start off by showing a couple of slides without having to call on them. If your students are really worried about anonymity, then you can give them aliases for the point of the class, et cetera. But since we don't have any of that, I would like to ask someone to share what you and your partner decided you would like to share with the group about what topic has been most interesting so far and why. Faculty can't follow directions. Do you know why the students follow directions? Because they don't get points for discussion section unless they complete their slide. So they are highly motivated. Yes.
So I don't know.
Sure.
The first one was perusal.
Okay.
And one of us had the idea of, wouldn't it be kind of neat to have the feedback, but then incorporate ChatGPT into it too, of like launching questions and giving them feedback. So,
okay, so they said perusal, and wouldn't it be great to find out, you know, what questions students have? And then, of course, we have to include ChatGPT.
We have to, because
just have
so,
to.
Yeah, if we're going to go with perusal.
So maybe we can do perusal where, like, students are encouraged to write their question, and then go to ChatGPT and get an answer. Maybe you switch. 50% of class, today you guys write questions, the other 50%.
Yeah.
And then I would say go along, they all have a good time.
I'm kind of simple, so I like the sentence framed, especially for the beginning of the semester when they don't know each other. I thought, okay, that was just
sentence frames or sentence starters, especially for the beginning of the term when students don't know each other, right? Because they have huge anxiety about getting to know each other. Actually, I will tomorrow, I will whip out the paper that I read this morning about active learning and its influence on students with the present. And as you can imagine, it's both bad and good, but there are some small tweaks to any active learning that really, really help students with depression. And one of those is keeping them in the same groups for the entire term, because then they don't have that anxiety of getting to know new people. It just came out this morning. Anyone else? Yes.
Well, I can report on this stuff that we never talked about before.
All right.
Because we kind of all said the same thing.
Okay, they all said the same thing.
Okay, so she said the peer learning, the peer instruction.
Peer instruction, right.
And because she's teaching an online course, and she could just imagine all the ways she could use that in an online course. But the rest of us, the other two of us, we already use peer instruction, so we weren't allowed to say that, you know, because then it wasn't something new. So we both said perusal, and our reason was because it's just like peer instruction.
All right. So one person is teaching with an online class and can imagine many ways to use peer instruction in that, although I'd be happy to talk to you about that because I sort of hack that and do that myself. And the other two already do peer instruction, so they didn't feel they could pick that. And so they like perusal because it's kind of like peer instruction. Yes, and we're going to take some Zoom feedback.
So Perla and Kate were both interested in active learning with peer instruction info, but also finds the strategies for EL students, sentence frames, pair and share, very helpful given the population they're working with.
Awesome. Thank you, Zoom attendees. We know life has been made extra difficult for you today because we have no internet access, or at least the majority of us do. So apologies for dragging you along rather quickly. So again, there's many ways to use this. One thing that's okay.
3 minutes.
One thing that's great. Again, I do an online discussion section, and we just, you know, my undergraduate tutors run it. They're like, how do I get points? They don't want to talk. They don't want to come up. So I was like, okay, this is what you do. And as long as they completed a slide, then they get their points for the class. And the students like it as well because it gives them something. Like people would always be like, I'm in a group, but nobody's talking. They're supposed to talk. Now they actually do talk, at least mentally, even if their cameras are still on. But I also think there's very exciting ways, if you have the capacity for your students to have computers in the room, to potentially use this in the room. Certainly that's what high school teachers do a lot. All right, so this is the, comparing here. If you imagine the whole Google slides are filled out, everybody got to speak. I mean, every student filled it in, that's inclusive, right? How many people were heard? Well, students can go look at other students' things. And if you want to know about individual students' thinking, then you can do that. So now is where I'm going to turn the mic over, both physically and virtually, to a few of my colleagues I asked to share some of the awesome, awesome things that they do. And we are going to start with Colleen, who's going to have to figure out for herself what she wants to do with Zumba.
Yeah, it'll be great. Okay, team, I've been reading about this thing called transparent teaching, and you're going to be like, Colleen, this is just good teaching. Do you know what I mean? You're going to be underwhelmed. But
Colleen,
I think it's
you have to be in camera range. There you go. Stay in the box.
Fancier. I actually look around the room, and I'm like, these are people who talk other people into using inclusive teaching practices. And so here are some things of like, if your homework assignment is tell students what they should learn, why it's important, what they should do, and how they'll be evaluated. People in this room are like, that's just good teaching. But it sounds fancier if you call it transparent teaching, if we're just like perfectly honest. And it really just tries to help take that hidden curriculum and make it not hidden. Personally, it took me years to do this to my homework assignments because I just like don't have that much time. Do you know what I mean? And so it's something that you can do a little bit. None of my students were like, Colleen, it was weird. Homework 3 did not tell me why this was important to learn. They don't maybe care. That's fine. It doesn't take a ton of time, and you can do it really slowly. Okay, there's good research results with it. So, yeah. So I think the research results are surprising how good they are, if we're perfectly honest. And so I'm like a little bit untrustworthy, but it does seem like just really bad if students don't know what they're supposed to learn or why it's important or what they should do, et cetera. So they have 35 faculty make these changes. They have specific rubrics and templates for you to use in just two assignments in half of their sections. And it impacted students' perceptions. So students self-reported academic confidence, sense of belonging, and mastery of important skills. And this was at least half a standard deviation increase specifically for these groups, first generation college students, low income students, and students from groups underrepresented in STEM. So it's exactly one of these things we see where good teaching helps students from groups underrepresented in computing or students who haven't had access to that sort of hidden curriculum. So I think this is one where, you know, you can just be like, this semester, I'm gonna do this in two assignments. Next semester, maybe only one, and eventually you'll get there. You can also try and trick your TAs or tutors into adding this content for you.
We have a question.
That's great. What falls under what is important? Is that specific, like what's important for the class or like what's important for their future career?
Thank you, it's both. The question was, what does important mean? And transparent teaching, they mean both why is it important for the learning goals in this class and what's gonna build upon it and why is it important to me in my life moving forward?
Okay.
Frank.
Yes.
I think Frank's up next.
You do want to talk about CS teaching tips?
Oh yeah, and CS teaching tips. Bajuchi Oja, who's a PhD student, is gonna be graduating soon, is gonna be passing around later on some stickers, just so you can be like, oh, Bajuchi Oja, I'm in synergy, she's awesome. Okay, sorry, no, let's check out then. Great, do you wanna have a Bajuchi Oja? She's really
fun. First, Colleen, you need a little more energy. I love CS teaching tips that are referred all the time, by the way. So thank you for setting that up. I really appreciate it. Years ago, I had a couple of textbooks, tried to get the students to read it before, and it was like pulling teeth. So the web was out, and I was like, you know, the web is so interactive. It'd be so much better to put a textbook online. So I got into this interactive textbook world, started writing all this interactive content, eventually had a company so I could have a bunch of people build the stuff. I'm going to see if I can get this YouTube video playing, Beth. Let's see. It's just 1 minute long. It'll kind of show you what an interactive textbook might look like. And you see, there's not a lot of text. There's a lot of activities. And that's the neat thing that the web provides. So here's an animation of how recursion works, a function calling itself. And you can see it just keeps creating new instances and then they disappear. And really hard to do that in a static textbook. You've got interactive questions. And it's always explaining things. If you get it wrong, it'll tell you why it was wrong and so on. And all the while it's recording to activity and you can even embed homework directly into it.
We have a question.
Yes.
It's not a question. We use Python to tutor websites to also show how things work. Similarly, for example.
Yep, it's not an e-textbook, but a Python tutor that a colleague of mine developed is also an awesome tool if you're not familiar with it. They also have Java tutoring.
So the idea is when we tell the students to do reading, they're actually doing things, they're clicking on things. A page of text is like a lecture, a bunch of questions with that same information is like a dialogue going back and forth. Watching an animation, I like to say a picture's worth 1,000 words, an animation's worth 5,000 words. So they're clicking and they're doing things and it's all getting recorded. And so they're earning points as they go along the way and they love that. I like to say points are the currency of academia. Yes, they should want to learn, but they love their points, right? We should love to teach, but you better pay me. So that's a nice feature about these interactive books. Does it work? Does it make a difference? So we did a randomized control trial where we took 250 students. We gave half of them a regular textbook in digital form, and we gave half of them this interactive material on the same subject. We gave them a pre-test and a post-test. So we saw 16% improvement among the students who have the interactive textbook. But the really exciting thing was the students who bombed the pretest, which is that little thing down here, we see they had a 64% improvement and we brought them almost up to the class average. So this interactivity really speaks to the students who come in weaker. And that's exciting because these are the students who are most likely to drop the class. Also kind of exciting is we didn't tell them how much time to spend and they voluntarily spent 2 times more time engaged in that material. We found a few universities, including University of Michigan. I don't know, remember Mary Lou Dorf? I don't know if you ever overlapped with her. And University of Arizona, UC Davis, big classes that taught these very mature subjects for many years, the same instructor, very similar exams, similar assignments. And they made this one change to an interactive textbook. And with that one change, we saw a 0.3 GPA improvement. And all the instructors attributed to the same thing. The students are coming to class more prepared. They were naturally starting to flip their classes and do peer instruction because the students already knew the three parts of the four loop. So there was no reason to go over. When UC Irvine said, hey, we want to change our 450 student CS1 class from a regular book to this interactive material, I said, hey, give them this survey, please, in the term that they were still using a regular book. The textbook contributes to my success in the course. And this is the agreement, strongly disagree, strongly agree, and so on. You can see it's all over the map. Then the next term, when they switch to the interactive book, you can see they're all on the left side now. It's some form of agreement that the book is actually helping them succeed. This is some data from a company called NavSTEM of the leading textbooks in the CS1 market. And this green one here is the interactive book that I was talking about. You can see it's just kind of like taking off. And I only have data on the company that I know about. So we have about 1 million subscriptions in 2023. So it's just kind of like in the last 5-6 years, interactive books. And there's other ones too. Runestone is really nice. It's an open source platform. You can build interactive books. I think, Barbara, your CS Awesome is on there, right? And there's some other ones, Dive Into Systems, that I've seen stuff, and some really nice ones there too. And I'll just wrap it up with this. The reason I got into this was I couldn't take it, the fact that we were losing so many of our majors. I was an undergraduate advisor for our computer science department back in the 2010s or so. We were losing about a third of our majors in just the first year. This is broken up by women. So we only retained 57% of our women and 63% of our men. And when we switched to this interactive material in 2012, you can see, and we did two things. We switched to that interactive material, and I made sure all our instructors were very supportive. We already had two that were great, had to let them go, and we brought in another one. And so we made all three were very supportive. So they were getting warmly welcomed, and you can see that our retention rates, and this is, it's been held steady now, around close to 90% since we made that switch. So, and the students say, oh, it seems like you really want me to learn. We're not just trying to throw them in the deep end of the pool, Stephen. So we really want them to learn. So thank you.
90%?
Yes. Wow. And we're a Hispanic serving institution, and the majority are on financial aid. So, yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Question.
Yes.
Do students need to pay to use this textbook?
I'm sorry, what?
Do students need to pay to use this textbook?
The one that I'm a part of, yeah. It's we have 170 employees, so they need to be paid to do if they do really good work. But there are also open source things, and like I said, Runestone is one of them. So there's a lot of different types of things coming
out. How much control does the instructor have over the content there? Or is it just like a paper textbook? Somebody wrote it and you just use it?
That's a great question. There's a lot of content that's been pre-written. So actually, our company has 90 in-house content developers, a lot of PhDs, and we obsess over clarity, quality. But you can reconfigure. So I like to reconfigure. So every chapter is a week. So it kind of helps with that sort of transparency, a little bit simplicity, just every chapter is a week. And then you can also write your own content. And you can have notes in the content. And I see instructors saying, I don't like what they're saying right here, so ignore this. And here's what I want you to learn instead. So give that sort of control.
Thank you.
excuse me, we talked about perusal. Can you use perusal with online textbooks?
No.
Anybody know?
That's
it. It's not online. Yes. I'm just wondering that question.
Yeah, they do allow you to use web pages slightly a little bit, but that integration would be crazy hard. All right. Thank you. 90%. All right, I'm welcoming up Helen Hu, who is joining us from Westminster College, just because a lot of people you've been hearing from today teach really, really large classrooms. I'll just tell you, Helen does not.
But POGL can be used with large classes, yes. POGL stands for Process-Oriented Guided Inquiry Learning. Camera, lawyer's not
here.
You're good. Okay, great. Oh, yes, I see it now. Okay, so, and the big idea, the core idea behind POGL is that how students learn is just as important as what they learn. And so we put the students in teams of 3 to 4 students, and they work through a POBL activity. And POBL activities actually remind me a little of Zybooks in that there is a model. So at the top of each activity, there's either a diagram or maybe even some code that has some concept that is hard for students to learn. And then that's followed by several questions that the students work to answer together. And so the guided inquiry part is the idea that these questions follow a learning cycle. So they start off with questions on explore, because we know that students don't actually look at the diagram unless you ask them questions about the diagram. And so we begin with some explore questions that might ask them, go look at those, the model, and maybe answer some questions about some new syntax, that what's new in that example, that model. And then there's a concept invention part of the questions, which we're going to lead the students to discover some new concepts for themselves. And those questions might lead to something where they have to explain that new syntax. And then the last part of these questions will be an apply. So an example of an apply question would be, okay, write some code now with those that syntax. The process-oriented portion of POBL stands for the fact that we're hoping that the students are going to learn some process skills as they work together in these teams. And so the activities are written so that we're scaffolding the teamwork, we're scaffolding the collaboration so that students actually improve on communication skills, they improve on collaborating, they improve on problem solving and critical thinking. If you want to access your POBL, the computer science POBL activities, you can go to this URL. And for the people in the room, I'm going to hand out a flyer which has that, so you can go home and see that. We can also, if you go to that URL, you'll learn about workshops that help you lead POBL activities. Because what we have found is people who've done it for a while, they improve at facilitating at POBL. When you do this, though, and Beth did have a little note at the top, this is not a small lift, because yes, it usually involves using the POBL activities a few times in your semester. So replacing entire class period with a POBL activity 4 times, 6 times, 8 times in your class. But what this does mean is it leads to students having an increased sense of belonging. They feel a lot more comfortable with each other. We've done some studies where we've seen that students might even have a better help-seeking behavior. They feel more comfortable asking for help from office hours, from other peers. We know that students in POBL classes have a higher pass rate than the non-POBL classes. And then this is one study we love. This one is our 60-20-22 paper, where we saw that when we quizzed the students in the next class on the first day on the material they were supposed to have learned in the previous class, the students who had POBL remembered it better, scored better than the students who hadn't. So there's a long-term effect on in using POBL in the classes. Thanks.
Awesome.
Are there any questions?
By the way, I just want to admit, balance isn't the only not light lift. Peer instruction is not a light lift. This is just the only one of this session who doesn't have a light lift.
But even if you're thinking, I'm not ready for a light lift, still go to the POBL CS workshop. I haven't adopted POBL, but I've been to their workshop, and everything they say is, we do this in this very intentional way because, and I'm like, oh, I should tell students like what roles they're playing when they do peer instruction after they've read one of Frank's Zybooks. Do you know what I mean? Like, so I feel like I literally, but do you know what I mean? And so I think that there, I'm on Helen's advisory board, but I really promise you that you'll get a lot out of going to a POBL CS workshop. Like there, okay. D, I have no animation, huh? That's so sad. Oh, I just screwed it up. I was gonna surprise you. So the first one, don't look at this. Look at the slides, people. Team. This is just like randomness about receiving feedback. That's what I want to talk to you. Don't read your teaching evaluations. Don't do it. Never, not even once. You have access to them. Do not read them. Find literally any human that has a reading level that can understand teaching evaluations and have them summarize them for you. A friend of mine can be like, hey, people love this. People want you to change this, this, and this. And three students really hate you. And here's the thing about that is, like, if you tell me three students really hate me, I'm not going to be able to perseverate on their exact words for the next semester. Do you know what I mean? And so you should literally never let any of your coworkers read their teaching evaluations. You should never read your teaching evaluations. I think the extent to which we maintain empathy for our students, and I think only if we maintain empathy for our students can we improve as educators. It's about trying to understand what they know, understand how they're feeling. Why are they not reading my textbook? And if I approach that with dismissal and not empathy, I'm never going to be able to create the environment I want to create.
Colleen, come back to the front.
Okay.
Everybody, just look to the side and ignore the slides. You're all very rebellious.
Well, you just got in trouble. I'm sorry. Next one, don't identify as a good teacher. So I used to identify as a good teacher. Students would like compliment my teaching. I'd be like, yeah, I'm so great. They mainly be like, you don't speak in a monotone voice. And I appreciate that because of my access to other instructors. No, but I think there's this key piece is if I identify as committed to their learning and not as good, then I'm open to their feedback. And so when I ask students for feedback, I say, if you write on this feedback form that you think I don't care about your learning, I will be offended. Even if you think it, please do not write it. That's rude and would be hurtful to me. If you think I am the worst instructor you have ever had in your whole life, please tell me that and help me get better. Do you know what I mean? Give me concrete things. So I intentionally separate my identity, which is as someone who gives a lot of shits about their learning, from the thing they might provide me feedback on. I might be real bad at this still. That's fine. Do you know what I mean? I'm trying. So I think that's a key piece. And I really think that in times where I have been identifying as a good teacher, I just haven't been open to their feedback that I'm doing a bad job. And I think I can't grow as a teacher unless I'm open to that feedback. When I started teaching, students would be like, oh, Colleen, it's not that you go too fast. It's not that you go too slow. It's that sometimes you go too fast and sometimes you go too slow. And I was like, oh, people in this room are like, oh yeah, like you don't have pedagogical content knowledge to know what's hard for them and what's not hard for them. So I think it's really important to be on that growth as an educator, to ask for feedback at the 5-minute level. So I have a chunk and then I'm like, made sense, didn't make sense. And every semester students invent the like extra didn't make sense. And I think it's I think we're not that consistent in the mistakes that we make when we're teaching because so much of it has to do with not understanding exactly what's hard for them. And so for me, I really need those, I need to improve each individual chunk and it helped me focus. I don't not just make all of my lecture better, but it's just like, oh, this part was real, real bad. Let me fix that part. My first years of teaching, I'm like, this semester, I'm gonna leave the classroom. I'm gonna go back to my office and I'm gonna sit and I'm gonna journal about what went well and what didn't go well. And then I'm gonna write these notes for myself to improve next semester. I'm like, it's like the teacher version of a New Year's resolution where it just never happened. So now I print out my lecture slides that I'm gonna use. And during class, I write on them, shit show, or whatever. And then the key thing is that I look at those before I prep the next time. Sometimes I haven't planned enough time because I get to them and I'm like, oh, right, this one was really, really bad. But having them somewhere that you'll actually find them, I think is key. And my key perspective is if you're not embarrassed about how you taught something last semester a year ago, you're not on the right trajectory. Like we should be growing and getting better at what we're doing. And there's no sort of ceiling to this, I think, because it's so hard to rock what our students know and need from us, and that's always going to keep changing. So please be embarrassed about how you used to talk about it. So that's my pitch. Oh, also talk all your colleagues into doing transparent teaching. Yeah, that sounds fancy. CFteachingTips.org. The douchey odor.
All right, awesome. Thank you so much, Colleen. As you can understand, why no students fall asleep at the University of Illinois Champaign-Urbana.
That's false.
Really, I'd like to see them. Okay, I have two additional colleagues that I really wanted to share things with you, but they could not be here. I'm going to start with my colleague, Dr. Tasha Franke. She is the department chair at San Diego Mesa Community College. And a couple of summers ago, she did a whole summer book reading with other computer science teachers of the book Grading for Equity. And I'm going to play her video, and I'm really going to hope that the sound comes through to the people who are on Zoom. And if not, I'll just tell you people on Zoom, you have the link to this so you can play it on your own.
Button. I'm going to turn on closed captions.
Yeah.
I see it right next to me.
Thank you. Here we go. Here is Tasha. I thought preloading was going to be a good idea, but not in this case. Let's let it buffer a little bit. All right, buffer not doing so well. Are you going to move? Let's give it a shot. Maybe that's as far as the preloads. Now we can't hear in this room.
There is a lot of practices. It's often really overlooked.
If I do that, we're going to have feedback galore. They told me that this was connected to that.
Maybe we can watch it tomorrow.
Yeah, we can absolutely watch it tomorrow. And we can also watch, we can come in first 10 minutes. We will watch that, and we will watch Cynthia Lee talking to us about what can I do today to create a more inclusive CS class. I'll just say we'll save the handouts if you want them. Give them tomorrow. If you feel like you desperately need to read Cynthia's pages tonight, you're welcome to come up and grab one. But we'll start off with that. And again, I'm just going to give you guys a little reminder of what we're going to do when we have internet connection tomorrow that isn't going to be nearly as important to have internet connection tomorrow. Is the following. We're going to just do a quick think, pair, share, say hi, see what we did. What's the best thing for you about returning to in-person learning? Everybody likes to talk about that. Just something nice. And then again, we're going to have three sessions. We're going to I equals zero, Y lesson three. You're going to spend 20 minutes selecting one of our topics there and moving to the table that we will have labeled, that I will remember to label with the topics. And then you're going to discuss for with those 20 minutes and learn and plan, and I've got a whole resources section. Resources, and so you guys will have the link to this, and you'll be able to access all those resources on your own, and I'll be around to answer questions, and maybe Colleen will as well. And then in the last 5 minutes, we're gonna have wall charts up there, and each of your groups is gonna share out the most important stuff you got. You'll be able to explore three different opportunities, because we'll repeat that three times. And then that's tomorrow's goal. And then tomorrow afternoon's goal is that you will be able to choose something and have a lot of individual planning time. Again, I'll also be here to ask questions of and things like that. So that's what we have. Any questions from the room or from chat before we go? It's been a long day, especially if you traveled this morning. All right, well, I'll let the group in the room go. See you later.
Yeah. Not a good person.